It is, of course, referring to the fact that despite the fact that I had been to the hyena den for maybe 20 times, I got lost going to it the other day. Thank you, Katie, for pointing that out to everybody. No, I don't need a map. I have Dave with me. He will remember where it is, so we should be okay. And then Katie in Nebraska, I'm not sure if you're the same Katie or not, but you want to know if birds have a sense of smell. Katie in Nebraska, birds do have a sense of smell, not all of them. For example, I think, if I'm not mistaken, the crowned lapwing doesn't have nasal passages anymore. They've closed up and they've been replaced by salt glands. But certainly many birds do, and the most obvious birds that do use their sense of smell extensively are the buzzards or New World vultures. So your vultures that you have got in the New World, most closely related to our storks, who also use their noses to find prey. So yes, very strong sense of smell many birds have. Thank you, Katie. That was the road I took last time to the hyena den. We got there in the end. Thank you, Jeffrey, for your kind comment that I'm being a good sport about it. Is it over here, Dave? Thanks. Okay, Dave says that we must go up here to find the hyenas. Brilliant. Thank you, Dave. Again this season, Dave. Oh, there's some further forward. Don't worry about those ones. Some better ones. For the baboon's tail, or zero fighter ready nervous, has started to flower again. It's called Zero Fighter Ready Nervous, the baboon's tail. You can see why it's called a baboon's tail. And for most of the season, it has been a dry, very unattractive kind of stump. No leaves on it at all, just those kind of baboon's tail protrusions coming out of the ground. And now, within a week of the rain, it has put out some new flowers. Isn't that lovely? Stunning flowers. It's interesting, and I don't know if they have a smell. Louise, I will try and find out if they have a smell, but obviously I'm going to get out of the car right here. But they are white, and so it's quite likely that they do have a smell. White flowers often have a smell, where red ones do not. Now, let's just pop up here. I know that there weren't any hyenas here yesterday evening. If they haven't moved. I've always had the impression that this was going to be a little temporary den for them for a little while before they pressed on. Now, Jamie, you want to know how often they change den. Well, they'll tell you, the books will tell you every 6 weeks or so. But they were at the den before this for at least 8 to 10 weeks. This one I've never seen occupied for more than 3 or 4 weeks. They ain't here. Now, it's quite possible that the youngsters are inside there, that the adults are still foraging or lurking somewhere in the bushes. But you can see there where they live, in that hole. But I don't see them here. So I think what we're going to do is check a few of the other den sites and see what we can find on our way. Hmm. interesting. I don't think they were here last night. Did anyone come and check?
Yeah, me and Brent did.
Okay, and they weren't here last night. Right, well, that's that then. Right, we'll go and check another site. An easy one to find. But Dave doesn't know. Dave's never been there. So he can't tell me. Hello, Diana. You want to know a little bit about the weather here and how cold it can get. Diana, you say where you live, it gets very cold and the pipes freeze sometimes. Diana, this is one of the great advantages, of course, of living in this area, is that the winter is arguably the best time of year here. It gets coldish to about 4 degrees Celsius, which is about 44 or so degrees Fahrenheit. Not very cold. And so no pipes freeze out here where we are. And then in the middle of the day in winter, it'll normally be around 20 to 25 degrees Celsius, which is, it's approaching 80, 75 degrees Fahrenheit or so during the winter time, which is a brilliant winter temperature. And there are some parts of South Africa which will get that cold. For example, parts of the Free State or the high-lying areas, a place called Belfast or Dullstroom, which are very high up, sort of 2,000 meters above sea level. That's about 6,600 feet above sea level. They will sometimes get freezing. And the eastern highlands of the Eastern Cape and down into the Drakensberg Mountains, they will drop below zero quite often. But the coldest place in the country is a place called Sutherland, and it will go down to, I suppose, sometimes minus 10 maybe during early morning. That's really a very, very cold day though, and that minus 10 will change during the middle of the day. Hello, Avril. You are Geraldine's mother. Now, you were most amused by the fact that I might have got lost going to the hyena den. As you can see, I did not get lost going to the hyena den there, Avril. Thank you for that. I would also like you to ask your daughter the next time she comes home to make you the new and improved cheesecake. Now, everybody, for those of you who don't know, Geraldine arrived with great fanfare a few weeks back and said she had a cheesecake recipe that she was going to share with us. And she was very specific about how this thing should be made and had very exact quantities. There are some hyenas there, or certainly one. Sorry, Dave. Come with us. And I'll continue the story, the sad story of Geraldine and the cheesecake, once we've had a look at this one. We get under here, Dave. There are cubs here. There's another one the other side there. Tracks off the road. Yeah, they moved. They've moved in here. Well, not all of them. That looks like the D. This just looks like Porky. Grunting and groaning as I try and turn the vehicle. This is a very recently excavated den, this one. This is Madden. This is matriarch. Those are not her two youngsters. That's D1 and D2, I think. That's the size they are. And this is a totally different situation. Isn't that a perfect little picture of them lying on their hole there? So what they would have done is excavated this burrow. They would have excavated some holes. And they would have created for themselves inside the den an easy place to sit. A safe place where no other predator can get in. So were a lion to come across here, they wouldn't be able to get their faces into where those little cubs are going to hide. And they will unfortunately probably go back down into the den now as the matriarch goes off. So the female is leaving. I find this really interesting. She's just over there. She's disappearing. This is a tiny, very unsalubrious neighborhood. Nothing like the two previous dens they had. Let's just see if my identification of these two little ones is correct. And the best way to do that is going to be to see the back left foot of the little one looking up into the air now. But I'm pretty sure that's who these two are. The D twins, born in December. It is quite strange. They should be out here on their own with no adults around. Their little claws. Now you can see their little claws sticking out there. And they'll be blunt, much like a dog's claws. And you can always see a hyena's claws in its track. Brazos, I agree with you. You say that the hyenas have gone den shopping. Yes, they do seem to have gone shopping for dens. They haven't found a very nice one here. I suspect quite strongly that this is a temporary refuge and that it's not going to be occupied for too long. I think Katie's absolutely correct. Katie, you say I've just been put on babysitting duty. As I arrived, the mother said, well, there you go. These are yours. You look after them. Of course, not their mother, that one. If these are who I think they are, I don't see how they could be anyone else, really. If there was some sort of upheaval last night, some kind of fight. A few of the crew went out on a night drive last night and found a hyena with a carrying a leg of some sort.
It was an antelope, presumably, was it?
I think so.
And so they were out and about, not too far from here. They'll probably go into the den. You can see them edging towards the hole. Much like the cats, of course, they will sleep for most of the day, although they're a little bit more active, thankfully. And that, that everybody, is that. James Richard, you say you wonder how long it will, if the hyenas wonder how long it will take me to find their new den. they move it? Well, in this case, not very long. It was right next to the road there. I mean, we were right next to the road there. Right, I think we should carry on with the story of Jerry and the cheesecake. So, somebody else has been in here, though. Somebody else has driven in here yesterday. I can see their tracks. So this is not as new as... it's not as new as yesterday. It must have been a day or two ago that they moved here. I'm still going to check the other one because I'm not sure that they're all there. Okay. So, Jerry arrived with a cheesecake recipe and very, very definite on how it should be made. And so she made a cheesecake. It was delicious. It was really delicious. Then she got it into her head, of course, that she needed help with this thing. And then no one helped her the second time she made it. And it was equally delicious the second time. And then the third time, she just refused to make it because no one would help her, you see. So Kirsten and I took up the mantle of the cheesecake chefs, and we made it ourselves. We made a few modifications. And the biggest thing that we did, of course, was freeze it. Because it's summertime here. And the camp went into raptures of joy when they tasted our frozen cheesecake, the very slightly modified recipe. Jerry, of course, by this stage had left for Johannesburg, and when she was sent pictures of this cheesecake and the camp basically lying about in absolute wonderment and joy at what they'd been given to eat, well, I feel that she became slightly jealous. Anyway, she returned the other day, and Jerry and I then made another frozen cheesecake. I do feel that she referred to me as a bad sous chef, which, given that I was teaching her the new recipe, I thought was a bit unfair. But she also had apoplectic fit when I didn't. I don't measure anything, you see. I just kind of guess the quantities, and well, like all great chefs do, you know. I mean, how often do you see Gordon Ramsay with a cup measure checking things, or Jamie Oliver weighing out how many chives he should put in his soup? He just knows. And with all great chefs, we just know. We have a feeling as to how much should go in the cheesecake, you see. And it was a roaring success. And the reason it's a roaring success, of course, is because if you freeze in something, it's very difficult for it not to be a success on a hot day out here. Sweet and frozen, delicious. I'm actually one of the world's worst cooks. So, I mean, the fact that we've managed to make this cheesecake is a testament to the ease of the recipe. Thank you, Jerry. You can make another one now if you like. You can go back to camp. Louise will handle the final control and we will have cheesecake for breakfast. Now, Geraldine is now challenging me to a souffle off. Jerry, you can happily have that one. You win. I'm not a chef. I'm not a cook. Souffle would unquestionably end up as a disgusting mush if I tried to make it. Okay, we're going to check the old den, see what's happening there, and then we'll head across to Buffleshook and see what's going on there. Kevin, that's interesting. You say, could the Nkuhuma ladies have caused the hyenas to move? No, I don't think so. Simply because I don't think they came from that direction. As you say, Kevin, the lions were calling most of last night. But they came from the east, and they didn't come from down here. So, no, I don't think that they would have caused them to move, especially not so close. You know, I mean, if hyenas will move their dens if there's a lot of predator pressure. But they are, I mean, they're so close to the old one. The old one, when we arrived there, I don't know if you smelled it, Dave, smelled quite niffy. There was a bit of smell of rotting something there. And maybe the disease was getting a bit bad. Dave, here is a pool of Coca-Cola. This is obviously not Coca-Cola, everybody. But it is one of those very rare pools out here that has been sand-filtered and unsoiled by buffalo dung. So there's some interesting little things that live in it, and
One of the things I, whenever I drive past this little pool, I hope to see is a green-backed heron. And a green-backed heron would sit on that branch on the top of your screen there, the very top of your screen, he would sit there and wait. He'd probably pick up an insect or a small leaf out and place it on the surface of the water as a bait for the fish. And then as the fish rise to bite on that leaf or that little insect that's been specially placed there, the heron would drop off the branch and grab it. But this is a fairly stagnant pond at the moment. And we were talking about mosquitoes earlier. Well, if the mosquitoes are going to come from anywhere, it is a pool like this one. Right. On we go. Hello, Claire. You're in New York and you say that hyenas seem to be largely scavengers, and how much of their diet is made up, that was a dung beetle flying overhead, how much of their diet is made up of kills that they make their own? Depends where they live. In this area, they're largely scavengers. They don't kill a great deal on their own. They will kill impala lambs during the lambing season because they're pretty easy to get a hold of. But over here, largely scavengers in East Africa, where the migration of wildebeest, 2 million of them, takes place, you'll find that they do a lot more hunting, and in some areas they even hunt more than lions. So it's very difficult to say what proportion of their diets are made up by scavenging and what by fresh kills. But I'd say in this area, and I'm guessing here, I would say probably about 80 to 90% is scavenging. Would be made up by live kills. They will, of course, eat anything. If they find an African bullfrog sitting on the road, they'll eat that. If they find a squirrel that is not paying attention, they'll eat that. So they will eat just about anything that has a meaty quality. Right, we're now approaching the old hyena den. Let's see if there isn't anything going on here. Lovely smell of the rain. Safari Dean, you're going to get yourself into trouble because you might find that this is the last time I ever acknowledge your presence. You say that you bet Jerry's cheesecake was better than mine. It most certainly was not. The only reason mine was better was that it was frozen. And of course, it is summertime here. No, this den has not been reoccupied as far as I can see. No tracks around here. I'm just going to pop out and I want to show you something quickly. Safari Dean. Something quite vicious here. I'm just going to try and retrieve it. It's called a... Oh, no. I had him. He's an ant. He's a vicious-looking ant. And I think he's known as the Matabele ant, if I'm not mistaken. He's huge. Can you see how big he is? With the big jaws? You don't want those things sticking into you. Isn't he wonderful? I could just hear some cracking of branches off to the side there. Am I making this impossible, Dave?
No,
you're right.
Perfect.
Isn't he amazing? The way he moves. Huge thing. He's about, well, I mean, you can see how big he is. It's a buffalo. Dave is a buffalo over there. Now, so often we found buffalo around here. They just seem to be on a path that grazes towards, I think, the Gallagher waterhole. It's not too far from here. And I think that's what they are going for. They're kind of nice grazing grass through here, through the woodland, and then they go for a drink there. I'm just going to very quietly sneak up here.
Many buffalo tracks. Definitely no fresh activity of the hyenas here. But what I did want to remind you of was that there was a pygmy kingfisher that nested inside this very cavity here. And it's precisely where those...
Speak up, James.
Precisely where those two hyenas we saw there, the little ones, were born. They were born in this hole, and inside it, a little kingfisher decided to nest with them. Now, I don't think the buffalo will be most pleased to hear me shouting across the bushveld like this so that you can hear me. So I think I shall get back into the car. In fact, he is... Look at him staring. As I got back into the car, he was looking at me as if to say, what do you think you're doing? Fair enough. Disturb the poor fellow. Okay, let's make our way out of here. And I think we will go to Boothel's Hook Dam now. Let's see what we can find there. I don't think we'll require the spotlight any longer, given that it is now daytime. Right, on we go. Flies have been very enthusiastic as a result of the rain. Oh, my earpiece is not in, of course. I wondered why I could hear nothing. Thank you, David. I've only been doing this job for almost a year. You can't possibly expect me to be able to remember those sorts of things. Clayton, you want to know about bullet ants. I've never heard of a bullet ant, and you say, are there any in South Africa? Clayton, I don't know, actually. I don't think so. I've never heard of a bullet ant before. But in the same breath, you want to know what animal has the worst sting here. Clayton, I think you'll find some members of the order Hymenoptera, so the wasps have some very nasty stings around here. And I was set upon, I've told the story before, I was on the golf course the other day, about, when was it, probably almost a year ago, in fact at least a year ago, and for me to be on the golf course means that I'm largely in bush, sort of this thick, looking for my ball. And I disturbed a nest of wasps that set upon my head. Now, the pain was utterly excruciating. I think I was stung about 50 times all over the top of my balding head. And I let out a very loud yell, and indeed may have said some words that would be unrepeatable on the live stream. That was very painful indeed. So I think it's probably a wasp that has the most painful sting, but you also get this thing called a blister beetle, which produces a poison called cantharidin, and that blisters the skin, and that's pretty unpleasant. And I was set upon by one of those the other day on my ankle, and indeed I showed everybody the incredible injury that it did to me. It didn't really do me an incredible injury, it does just blister the skin, and it's not so much sore as it is uncomfortable and very strange. But they're not a lot of... People are often afraid of insects. Well, they're afraid of snakes more than before they're afraid of anything. Then spiders and then insects. And we don't have a great deal of spiders that are particularly harmful. In fact, we've got hardly any. And we don't have any insects that are particularly dangerous. Of course, the two most dangerous insects, I guess, are the mosquito, the Anopheles mosquito, which carries malaria and lives in that coke pond. Well done, David. And
The other, I suppose, would be the common bee, because if you're allergic to a bee sting, of course, it can be fatal. I am mercifully not allergic to bees. Here comes some... Okay, so a bullet ant. A bullet ant is a bullet ant is found in the New World. So in the forests of apparently Paraguay, Honduras, Central America, and possibly up into the United States. And it's a very powerful sting. It's named for that very powerful sting that it has. It is in lowland forests. Thank you very much. I didn't just suck that out of the ether. That was read to me on my earpiece. Thank you, Louise and Jerry. And then, of course, I mean, we were talking about stings of insects, and as has just been pointed out to me, the worst kind of a sting that you can get here is not from an insect, but an arachnid, like a Parabuthus scorpion. And the Parabuthus scorpion will give you a very nasty neurotoxic puck, which you will require you to be hospitalized. So we try and avoid those. There is a very humble dove, but we very seldom look at them. There we go. Oh. So we seldom actually get to see a really nice shot of the ring-necked dove. We hear them all the time, but often we don't have a chance to see them. We've got a question from a viewer here about whether or not... Sorry, I've actually totally slipped my mind. Louise, can you go again with it? Water around, which means that even if it does urinate, it will be able to find water. And I just want to show you something. Because it's a hinged tortoise, just put your little leggies back there. Just quickly. This is called a hinged tortoise because of the hinge there. And I don't know if you can see it there, but there's a little kind of shell, piece of the shell there, that closes up. And you may even be able to see it moving. There, you can see a little bit of articulation there. Can you see that?
Yes.
So that is why it's called a hinged tortoise, everybody. I'm going to put him down now. Now, as I say, we wouldn't normally pick a tortoise up because they can sometimes void their bowels. They'll go to the loo, and then if it's very dry, that can result in them dehydrating. But because it's so wet at the moment, I'm not worried about that at all. So just a quick one to show you why he's called a hinged tortoise. And they live in termite mounds. We learned that from Renius the other day. They will go and live in the mud in termite mounds. And his uncle used to apparently be something of a specialist tortoise hunter. And he'd know how to find them in the termite mounds and find five or six in one mound. So back onto the wasps, and basically the general function of any kind of animal out here is that they don't only ever fulfill some part of a food chain. So they will always eat, they have to eat, and so they will be eaters of things. They will be eaten, so they are both prey and predator, even if what they prey on is grass or something like that. And you can very quickly see that if every single creature out here is being eaten or is eating, quite apart from, say, the pollinating role that they might play in the environment, and many wasps do that, and I'll tell you about that now, quite apart from that, if you take one of those things out of the system, so let's pretend that wasps were only here or didn't do anything other than eat something and be eaten. If you take them away, whatever they eat, their numbers are going to explode, and whatever eats them, their numbers are going to decline. So just by removing one thing from an ecosystem of infinitely complex balance, you can immediately upset the apple cart and the ecosystem will change profoundly. It doesn't necessarily mean that it changed for the worse or for the better, but it will change. And so everything out here contributes to the amazing balance or dynamic equilibrium that we have out here, be it a wasp, be it an aphid, be it an Anopheles mosquito carrying the parasite for malaria. Now wasps, there's a group of them called the fig wasps, and fig wasps, unsurprisingly, live in figs. But every single fig species in the world, as far as I know, has its very own species of wasp that pollinates it. Isn't that amazing? So without that species of wasp, the figs would not be able to pollinate. And what happens is that the females never actually leave the fruit in which they are laid. So let me just get this straight. So what happens is how does it work? Let me just think about this for a second. It might be the male that never leaves. I think it's the male that never leaves. So the female will go to the wasp, she'll lay an egg inside it, or an egg or two inside it, and they will hatch inside the fig. But the fig's entrance tunnel through which the wasp can go can only be accessed by exactly the right species of wasp. No other wasp will be able to fit through, or no other insect will be able to fit through the entrance to that fig. So once the female's gone in and laid her egg, what she does is she leaves, and the eggs will hatch. The female of the next wasp will hatch and then eventually go out of the fig flower or fig fruit and go off, find another one and go in. And as she goes in, she'll be grabbed by the male wasp inside that fruit. She'll mate with him, she'll lay her eggs, and I think she flies off again. Now that continual movement in and out of the carpel. That continual movement deposits pollen on the back of the wasp, and the pollen will then be transferred from fig to fig. One wasp species dependent completely on one fig species, which I think is just astonishing. Right, we're out on the lethal subcut line now, hoping to find something in the way of interesting animal life. Oh, sorry, there's one thing back here I do want to show you. Siberia Zumi. The other day, of course, Jamie had the most remarkable sighting of a lioness with a tortoise like the one I've just picked up there. And the tortoise climbed underneath the lion's paw, which was extremely odd because lions do eat tortoises. And so Siberia Zumi, you say you thought tortoises lived under the armpits of lions. Well, I think that's a pretty good thought, really. Now, what we're going to do here is approach this burrow with great care. David, don't make any sudden movements. It is just now. Always knock when you come to someone's home. Now you can see that this burrow is freshly excavated, and it's been excavated by a family of warthogs. In fact, there were two sows and five piglets that lived in this burrow, and I'm sure they still do. They're probably out foraging now, but certainly you can see where they live. And normally they don't like it if a predator or something noisy comes up. They'll normally explode out. Now, Tingana, of course, our favorite male leopard, he sits above a mound like this and he waits for the warthogs because he's able to tell if they're still inside or not. I can't. I don't have the same sense of smell or hearing. But the other thing that people used to do out here, and this was again Renius was telling me the other day, was that people used to hunt warthogs. Now, I asked him while we were tracking how it was that people lived out here. How was it possible to live out here without growing something to eat? Can you hunt and gather sufficient food out here to survive? And his answer to me was, yes, to a certain extent. You cannot eat sufficient fruit and roots to survive without hunting. Now, hunting, of course, is not easy if you don't have a sophisticated bow and arrow system, which the Shungans never did. And so hunting something like an impala or a steenbok, either has to be done with trapping, or you hunt a warthog like this. And what you do is find a burrow like this and you wait outside it. The warthogs could still be in here, I don't know if they are or not. But what you do is you sit above the entrance hole like this, and if you can sneak up on it, if you know they're in here and you can sneak up from behind without them realizing, they will almost certainly stick their heads out once they feel you walking up on top of it. And then you bang them on the head as they come out. And that's how you would hunt a warthog out here. And of course, as Renius was explaining to me, one warthog would feed a family for probably more than a week out here. And so an almost entirely sustainable way of hunting if there are not too many people living in the area. No warthogs there, I don't think. Let me refold my blankets so that I may look as tall as Brent Leo Smith. See how tall I am, though?
Very tall.
I'm a massive human being. Massive. Okay, let's just continue. Very kind comment from the anonymous cheesecake insulter, who says she's very pleased that I answered the question despite the fact that she's in safari detention. Precipitation coming out of here. Oh, Clayton, thank you very much. You've been very complimentary about what we do out here. That's very kind of you. Thank you. And you should say, you've been hooked for the last few weeks. Your first drive was the one where we had those 10 wild dogs setting upon a hyena. That was the most amazing sighting. And if that was your first drive, well, I'm not surprised you got hooked. Of course, that doesn't happen all the time out here. We don't never know what's going to happen out here. But what a great start to your safari experience. Thank you, Clayton. Water coming out of the sky now, which is slightly disconcerting, but nothing that is going to stop us continuing for now. Hyena tracks, buffalo tracks. And you want to know if there is more than one kind of hinged tortoise. There's only one that we get here. I think there are two or three other hinged tortoises in the world, or certainly in Africa. I don't know what they are, though. My reptile knowledge is not perhaps what it should be. But yes, yes, we do get a few other kinds of hinged tortoises, not here. We only get the two tortoises here, the Speke's hinged tortoise, which is the one we've just seen, and of course the leopard tortoise. And we saw a massive leopard tortoise yesterday. Probably, it must have been a foot and a half across. It was a massive thing. So at least 70 years old. Which is pretty old for an animal out here. 70 years ago, of course, Dave, was what? What year was it 70 years ago? It would have been 1946. That's quite something. 1946. Just after the end of the Second World War. Which, of course, wouldn't have affected that tortoise's parents at all. In South Africa. Just over there is a little steamboat. Steamboat, don't just move very slowly on the ground. You see it? Little Steenbok, you who thinks we can't see her. Of course, her strategy for staying away from the jaws of a predator is to lie underneath a bush like that and stay dead still. Hence the name Steenbok, which means stone buck. She's just not quite convinced whether we can see her or not. We haven't attacked her, which confuses her. So sorry about that signal breakup, everyone. That's just, I'm afraid, seems to be the way of things at the moment. And I think a large portion of the problem is due to the fact that we are, I mean, none of the equipment that we use is designed to be shaken around like it does get shaken around. And so inevitably, as we modify things going forward, there will be bits and pieces of time when we are not with you. So I'm sorry about that. She's not trying to smell the air. Now you see that? That's interesting. She's lifting her top lip there, and I'm sure there's an element of that phlegmon that they do there, that she's opening up the tract to the Jacobson's organ, which will interpret what she's smelling in a much more powerful way than just kind of sniffing. Just pointed out, and I can't actually see it from here. No, she's moved. There she's up. She's a tiny little thing, about 20 pounds. Oh, there it is, it's just fallen off. It was a moth. On the left hand side of her face was a moth. Now, just watch her. What I wanted to see was whether she was going to defecate or not. And the interesting thing about a Steenbok defecating, because most animals are profoundly uninteresting when they're defecating, is that they bury their dung within their territories, and they're the only antelope species that I know of that does that. Look at that. They're hiding, just looking, and that's it. Good. Here comes the sun. Interesting question from James Richard, sorry. You want to know which antelope species has got the largest horn to body ratio? In other words, which antelope? Here I think probably the kudu. They've got horns for their size when they're moving around. out here or in southern Africa, those would be the two. Those I would guess those two. Maybe a sable, like a really big sable bull, might have horns that were slightly larger or have larger ratio. So I think those ones certainly have things like that, little stabbing horns. And I think a lot of very large antelope have got horns that are also for display, not just for fighting. Whereas the stirrups, little stabbing fence. Fighting other males. Right, we're now in the Far East, hoping to maintain signal. Seems to be okay for now. Not a huge amount going on out here in the Far East. Lovely wildflower, let's have a look at. Brent Leo Smith, of course, is our wildflower expert at the moment. Barbara, can you see this yellow thing here? Can you see it? I'll just get out and turn it for you, everybody. Now, this is called a commelina, or wandering Djuma, and this is the yellow commelina, so called because it is in fact yellow. The others are all blue as far as I know. I think it might be a white one as well, but normally they are blue. But they've all got that very distinct shape. That is the yellow commelina. It's quite a nice one. And this one is actually, and this is the first year I've noticed this, this is called a Chinese lantern or Dicrostachys cinerea, plenty of them around, has got a really kind of subtle smell, and it smells, no, I'm giving it to you to smell, David.
Oh, thank you.
There you are. Good grief. Can you smell it?
Oh my God, it's lovely.
Lovely, hey. Very subtle smell, and it smells exactly what you think a pink thing should smell like. I don't know how better to describe it. Anyway, I only discovered that this year. I've spent many, many years around Dicrostachys cinerea. This is the first time I've smelled it. I'm taking this blanket out because I can no longer move. There we go. I've just got shorter. I'm sorry about that, everyone. Right, on we go. Then a question from Mike about what my favorite animal out here, outside of South Africa is. I don't know. I think what I would really, I mean, I don't know why I say this, but what I would really like to see is a wolf. I would really love to see a wolf, especially a wolf perhaps on the hunt. So perhaps one day I should see some wolves in the wild. That would be brilliant. Bear, of course. Everyone wants to see a bear. Jim Butler, that's a very, very good question as to why we don't see young steenbok. Where are all the young steenbok? Jim, I think you'll find that they are too well hidden in thick, thick bush. Very, absolutely right. I mean, it's hardly ever. I've never shown one on live drive before. And I mean, you know, they're tiny. I mean, they're the size of a rabbit, basically. So, in thick bush. Good one. Excellent question. You can see the big clouds coming in here. I also want to find another baboon's tail so we can smell it in a slightly less close proximity to what we thought was the hyena den, but is no longer. Oh, lovely light. Look at the way the sun's come out. Ah, Yes, X-Ranger, absolutely correct. We are heading towards breakfast. And you say you think that I came to the Far East not for good or bad signal or indeed for any animal, but because I am seeking out a Singapore noodle stand. I am hungry. I won't tell a lie. I can't say that I've found any noodle stands out here yet, though. I have found some very bright sun, though. Which is a nice change. Good morning. Elizabeth, nice question from you about wild sheep and goats, and do we have any out here? And you're thinking of the bighorn sheep, of course. Elizabeth, no, nothing in South Africa like that. Remember, sheep and cattle and goats were domesticated from wild animals, some of which would have been related to the bighorn sheep. But no animal has ever been domesticated properly in Africa. So there have been attempts at domesticating things like eland, which are very large spiral-horned antelope. But otherwise, no animal has been domesticated here, which means that any domestic animal here is not going to have a local relative in the wild, if that makes sense. Now, if you didn't know better, you might suspect that you were looking at the same species, one older closer to us and two younger behind. But those are two impala with one beautiful Nyala bull. Perfectly bathed in the early morning light. It's very pretty. The impala was starting to look a bit ropey until a few days ago, and I think now that they will start to put on condition as a result of the extra grass and moist leaves that they have to eat. There we go. A little hop, skip, and a jump. And they're just over a year old. They were born in November 2014. I know that because of the size of their horns. Well, you know roughly their age from the size of their horns. And then, of course, it's very easy to guess when they were born, because they're all born within 2 weeks of each other in late November or early December. So we can tell probably to within 2 weeks how old those things are. Right, on we go. Interesting trees up ahead here. And they're interesting largely because they're not common out here. And because Liam asked about them, he said, James, do you get any false marulas around here? At which point I said, yes, Liam, there are three over there. And look at them growing rather beautifully, sleekly, in this termite mound with the sun behind them peeping through the graying clouds. A very artistic scene, wouldn't you say, David?
Absolutely.
Yes. And they're growing out of a termite mound because that's a fertile place for them to grow. And I think that's a really amazing thing that these three trees are growing out of the same termite mound, and I suspect that they might actually be the same plant. It might just be a very ancient plant that's got three stems coming up out of the termite mound. And that is a false marula, so called because it looks like a marula but isn't one. It's just the bark is quite similar. Once you've seen them both though, especially not with the backlight, you'll be able to distinguish them immediately. Lania schweinfurtii, another one of the wonderful Latin names that we get out here. Lania schweinfurtii. Say at least 10 Latin names of a tree before going live so that one's lips are ready to speak with clarity and crystalline eloquence. The other word that one should use, of course, when one is warming up one's voice is one should say the name of the actor, Benedict Cumberbatch. Warm up your lips. apes. Now, Mr. Barrington, you would like to know about the lions and the prides and just get a general update of the lay of the land, where how things sit. Well, things have set at the moment, and I might actually be able to draw you a map. There doesn't seem much else going on out here at the moment, so let me find a patch of sandy soil, and I shall draw you a map of where the lions are and who they are. And of course, this is because I am such a immense... I know of a little patch of sand just up ahead here, where we shall draw for you a map. The big thing to remember, of course, is that we have prides, which are made up of females and their related offspring. We have got coalitions of males, which are not part of the pride, contrary to the popular belief and contrary to what the Lion King has spread amongst any number of other lies. It's not to take away. Patch of sand up ahead here. Right, here it is. And Arvid, my palette will be over there. I will no longer be in communication with Louise. Now, lions.
Remember, you're going to have to speak quite loud, James.
I will speak with a great volume in my voice. David, can you hear me?
Loud and clear.
Marvelous. Now, here is, we'll do the whole Sabi Sands, I think. That is the Biffleshook cut line. The Simbambili cut line. Down like this it goes. Across the way, out. Something like that.
Wait, we're not seeing that, James.
We're not seeing that. Where? How much have you got?
Just to, after the curve,
after
we
the
lose
curve.
You.
All right, we'll have to descale slightly. Stand by. Sorry about that, everyone. Okay, start again here. North, yes. Correct.
Yes.
Yes. Something like that. So there's the Sabi Sands. We're only going to deal with the northern section because that's all we know about. Here is the Gowrie Gate. That's where we come in. And Djuma is as this. Well, there's Biffleshook. That's Biffleshook. Djuma like that, and Torchwood like that. Cheetah Plains, and Nkoro, Chitwa Chitwa, Hoffman's and various others. Very good, isn't it, Dave?
Lovely.
Simbambili, Arathusa, Elephant Plains, North. South, west, and the last one, east. Right, so we are sitting over here in the northeastern section of Djuma. Well, sort of mid-southeast actually, probably about there. Now, there are three main prides that we know of, but only two that we really see. The Nkuhuma pride, and their territory is this. That's the Nkuhumas. So they've got Djuma, and they've go a little bit onto Torchwood, a little bit into Arathusa as well, actually, like that. and some bambini.
Nice big territory. That is... that is the Nkuhuma pride. Okay? The other pride we know of is the Talamati pride. They go north and east into Kruger. So that's the Talamati pride, north and east into Manuleti and into Kruger. And then south of us, of course, is the Styx pride. And they go all the way into Malamala. Malamala is here. Now, overlaying these two prides and more prides to the south are the Birmingham boys. So you can see the Birmingham boy territory encompasses at least three pride territories. That's where they are. And then in the north here, we've got the Salati males, two big males who have a territory going like that. Smaller than the Birminghams, but they've probably got the Talamati pride and another pride into Manuleti. That's the lay of the land. Further to the west, you've got the Majingalan coalition of males, but I'm not even going to attempt to draw where they are. And then you've got some others to the south of that. And that, everybody, is how the lions look. Not like much from this angle. I should have perhaps drawn a lion. Gosh, I'm absolutely hopeless. I thought I was being totally crystal clear until I actually looked at the drawing I made. So I hope that while the finished product would have been utterly confusing, perhaps the actual drawing of it was slightly less confusing. I suspect not. Thank you, Anna Marie, for your kind comments on my artwork. Hopeless. Hopeless. Siberia Zumi, you say I'm horrible at drawing a hopscotch. I have to agree. I think I'm horrible at drawing anything. Ah, Christy, thank you. You think I could get a job as a cartographer? I agree. I think my ability to demonstrate proportion on the roadside with a stick is exceptional. Thank you very much. I especially like the way that all the different pride territories look so different and that they were clearly separatable and obvious. So anybody driving along there would know exactly what was being drawn. And Louise says I should have used more colours. Well, that's probably fair enough. Lion prides and sepia. Jerry, of course, apart from being a fine exponent of cheesecake, is also one of these new people, new very modern adults who likes to colour in, and she's got pencil crayons, so she says I can use some of those when I next draw on that. Thank you very much, Jerry. Lion, you say it's like a game of lion twister. Yes, I suppose it is. A very confusing one. It is amazing to me, though, how some people just have the ability to draw and some don't. Yes, James Richard, very nice comment there. You say, last time I drew an elephant, I confused it for a river dolphin. Yes, it did look like a river dolphin. I initially thought a kiwi bird. I was accused of making it look like a duck-billed platypus, my generous person on camera. And I think river dolphin, James Richard, is probably more accurate. It did look like a river dolphin.
I can actually answer this question. You want to know what the wild dog territory looks like on that map? Simon, it covers the whole map. Basically, we've got two packs that use this in the whole of the Sabi Sands, one slightly more to the north than the south, so you can probably split it halfway down, but there's lots and lots of overlap. So for me to try and draw that, can you imagine me trying to draw the overlap between two territories? That would be almost impossible. Lions, of course, don't have an enormous amount of overlap. There's very little overlap between the female territories. But they're not nearly as defined as I did draw them. I mean, and certainly if you look at the data of where the different sightings of the prides have been on a GIS map, it's very interesting. Thank you, Jennifer and Nora and Heidi. You say that the map was very helpful to you in understanding the lion dynamics. I'm very pleased indeed. And the other thing you can get from that map, of course, is you can see why the Nkuruma pride is not always here, why they're often somewhere else, because most of their territory isn't on Djuma. Now, I was hoping to find a whole lot of baboon's tail flowers here. I can see some baboon's tails, but I can't. There's a whole patch of them just down around here. I've spotted one. There we go. Covered two flowers here. One the baboon's tail, which is the sort of bright purpley one, and then one the blue commelina, or the other wandering Jew. Let me just have a smell. So here is the baboon's tail. It actually smells delicious. It really does smell nice, like a really subtle lily. I'm not going to pick it for David. David, here is the blue commelina, or the blue wandering Jew. And that is without a scent. It doesn't have any smell at all.
Lou's asking if you can bring her one back.
No, smell. I cannot bring you one back, Louise. That is illegal. Do not pick wildflowers here unless there are very, very many of them. Certainly not while live. We might consider taking one home to plant it if we weren't live, but that's a matter for another time. Close here. So delicious smell that comes off. As I suspected, because it's white, many of the white flowers out here have got this. Trying to meddle with the things that we are doing out here. I suspect it's got something to do with the weather and the unfathomable impossibilities of trying to get a high-definition signal out of the bush. Don't worry, Alex is on it, Eugene is on it, and so is everybody else. Thank you, everyone, for talking to me throughout the last 3 hours. It's been great fun. I've had a wonderful time, especially with those lions. Thank you, David, for your immense abilities today. Nearly threw him off during that lion sighting by mistake. A big thanks, of course, to Louise and Jerry in the final control. We will see you later on today at 4 o'clock this afternoon. Not sure how many vehicles will be out, but stay safe and happy wherever you are, and we will see you then. Bye-bye.